often when you're taking derivatives, you're going to come across problems in which you have to use multiple derivative rules in the same problem. So, for example, you might have to use the product rule and the chain rule, or the product rule and the quotient rule, or maybe three rules, product, quotient, and chain rule. So, when you're working on these problems, it's important to always take things one step at a time and just try to be really organized in your work. And when you're trying to decide which rule to use first, just try to start by looking at sort of the overall structure of the problem. So let's start with this problem here. The derivative with respect to x of e to the x squared plus 1 times sine of x cubed. Okay, so I expect I'm going to have to use multiple rules on this problem because I have a product of two functions, but then those functions themselves are kind of complicated. But what rule am I going to start with? Well, in this case, I'm going to start with a product rule, because if I look at sort of the overall structure of this function, overall it's composed of two pieces, e to the x squared plus 1, and then sine of x cubed. So I'm going to start out with the product rule in this case. So remember, the product rule is first times the derivative of the second plus second times the derivative of the first, or the other way around, however you remember it. So if we just start writing this down, I've got the first, e to the x squared plus 1, times the derivative of the second. And that derivative is going to be a little complicated, so I'm just going to leave it like this for now. Like I said, we just want to take things one step at a time. Okay, plus the second, sine of x cubed, times the derivative of the first, e to the x squared plus 1. Okay, so we've done the product rule part of this. Now what we have is we have the derivative of these two pieces that we're going to have to think about. Okay, so next line, I'm going to start working on this derivative of sine of x cubed. And I'm just going to put that in big brackets. So the derivative of sine of x cubed. Now, to take the derivative of this piece, I'm going to need to use the chain rule because I have a composition of functions. I have sine, which I know the derivative of, but then inside the sine, I've got x cubed. So remember, the chain rule says that I take the derivative of the outer function, and I keep the inner function in there, and then I multiply by the derivative of the inner function. So if you remember, the derivative of sine is cosine. So the first piece of this is just going to be cosine of x cubed. That's the derivative of the outer function, keeping that inner function in there. Now I'm going to need to multiply by the derivative of the inner function, which in this case is x cubed, so its derivative is 3x squared. Okay, so let me just add some parentheses here just to be sure we realize that these pieces are separate. Cosine of x cubed and all that times 3x squared. All right, so let's keep going. We pretty much finished that first part of the problem, but we still need to tackle this other derivative. Okay, so I've got sine of x cubed times this other derivative, which once again I'm going to put in big brackets. So notice here I'm taking things, like I said before, one step at a time, and I'm just thinking about one derivative at a time. So now I'm only going to focus on taking the derivative e to the x squared plus 1. Don't even worry about all this other stuff out to the side. So once again, I'm going to have to use a chain rule here. I have a composition of functions. I have e, which I know about taking the derivative of that, but then it's raised to the x squared plus 1 power. Okay, so chain rule, once again, we start by taking the derivative of the outer function, which in this case is just the exponential function, so its derivative is itself. So this part just stays the same. I keep the inner function, and then the chain rule says I have to multiply by the derivative of the inside function. So here my inner function is x squared plus 1, so I'm going to be multiplying by its derivative, which is 2x. And that's it. So actually now I'm completely finished taking the derivatives. all I might want to do here is clean this up a little bit. So let's see if there's any common factors that both terms have. So you see here we have two terms, and each is the product of multiple pieces. Is there anything that both terms have in common? Well, they both have a factor of x, at least, one factor of x. And they both have this e, this factor of e to the x squared plus 1. So I'm going to pull those terms out in front, and then let's see what we have left over. Well, from the first term, let's see, I took the e, I took one of the x's. So I have just 3x left over, and then I have cosine of x cubed left. And then from the second term, well, I took out my x, so I have a 2, and I took out my e, so I just have 2 sine of x cubed. And this is my answer. All right, let's do another problem in which we have to use multiple derivative rules at once. So here I have the derivative of the quantity 3x over 4x plus 2, and that's all raised to the fifth power. Okay, so this is a little complicated. I've got a quotient, but the quotient itself is being raised to the fifth power. So I want to start by thinking what's kind of the outermost structure or the overall structure of the problem. So the kind of outermost feature here is the fact that this is all being raised to the fifth power. So I want to start by working with that fifth power. With these problems, you're always going to try and kind of work from the outside in. Okay, so I've got something raised to the fifth power. But that something is a little complicated. So what I'm actually going to have to do is use the chain rule and the power rule. So let me show you what I mean. So we know that if we have x to the fifth and we take the derivative of that, well, that's just 5x to the fourth. So that's what I'm going to do here. But I'm going to have to use the chain rule because it's not just x that's raised to the fifth power. It's this entire quantity here. But the chain rule says that I start by taking the derivative of the outer function and leave the inner function inside. Okay, so if I do that, I'm going to pull the 5 down front. I'm going to leave my inner function intact. Okay, so I've taken the derivative of the outer function, essentially, so far. But then the chain rule says I need to multiply by the derivative of the inner function. So I need to multiply by the derivative of 3x over 4x plus 2. Okay, so let's keep this 5, 3x over 4x plus 2 to the fourth out front. We'll just take that out of our minds, and we'll just focus on now taking the derivative of this quotient. Okay, I'm going to put big brackets here to give me plenty of room to work. So this is a quotient. I'm going to want to use a quotient rule. Okay, so quotient rule says I'm going to do the bottom, 4x plus 2, times the derivative of the top. Let me go ahead and write out that step. Times the derivative of the top, 3x, minus the top, times the derivative of the bottom, and that's all over the bottom squared. Okay, so we have a few more derivatives to take within those brackets, but we've done the hardest steps now. Okay, so I still have this out front. Okay, so let's clean up the numerator here. So I've got 4x plus 2, and that's times the derivative of 3x, which would just be 3. Minus 3x times the derivative of 4x plus 2, which would just be 4. And that's all over 4x plus 2 quantity squared. Okay, I can actually do a little bit of simplification within those brackets. If I multiply out on the top there, So I've got 3 times the quantity 4x plus 2. If I distribute that 3, that's going to give me 12x plus 6, but then I have minus 12x. So you can see those 12x's are going to go away. And then what I have is, still out front, I have this 5 times 3x over 4x plus 2 to the fourth. And then this fraction, I have 6 over 4x plus 2 squared. Now, there are several different ways you could go about rewriting this, simplifying it. So I'm just going to show you one of those ways. I've got a 5. Okay, so all these three pieces are being multiplied together, right? So I've got a 5 and then I've got a 6, both in the top. So I'm going to combine those and make that 30 in the numerator. And then I've got 3x to the fourth power from this first fraction here. So I'm going to kind of separate that out and just write it 3x to the fourth. I can separate fractions like this. If the whole fraction is being raised to the fourth power, that means both the numerator and the denominator are being raised to the fourth power. So then I've got 4x plus 2, and that's in both fractions. In the first fraction, it's being raised to the fourth power, and in the second fraction, it's being raised to the second power. So if I combine those, it's being raised to the sixth power overall. And this is my final answer. Okay, let's do one more. So once again, we see here we have a sort of complicated problem that we want to take the derivative of. I expect that I'm going to have to use multiple rules here because I have a quotient, but the numerator is a product. So to pick my first step, though, I want to look at sort of the outermost feature of the problem. I always want to work from out to in, if that makes sense. So here, overall, this is a quotient. So I want to start by using the quotient rule. So the quotient rule is the bottom, x plus 1, times the derivative of the top, minus the top, times the derivative of the bottom. And that's all over the bottom squared. Okay, so now I need to work on taking those derivatives that I have still to take. So on top I've got x plus 1, and then I have times the derivative of x e to the x. But the derivative of x e to the x is going to require me to use the product rule. So I'm just going to do that in these parentheses here. So remember product rule, first times the derivative of the second plus second times the derivative of the first. So first times the derivative the second plus second times the derivative of the first. Okay, we'll come back to those in just a second. And then if I keep going on the top there, I've got minus x e to the x times the derivative of x plus 1. Well, that's a nice easy one. The derivative of x plus 1 is just 1. And that's all over this denominator, still x plus 1 squared. Okay, so we have a little bit more work to do on the top there. So x plus 1, in my parentheses, x times the derivative of e to the x. Well, that's just e to the x. So that's x e to the x plus e to the x times the derivative of x. But the derivative of x is 1, so e to the x just stays itself. And then minus x e to the x over x plus 1 squared. So actually I can simplify this numerator a little bit. If I just kind of glance at it there, I suspect that I might have some terms that cancel out. So to see if that's actually the case, I'm going to actually FOIL these first terms. So you'll see I have two sets a parentheses there that are being multiplied together, and I'm going to FOIL them out. So the easy way to remember FOIL is first, outer, inner, last. So I'm going to start by multiplying the first terms. So that's x times x e to the x, which gives me x squared e to the x. Outer plus x e to the x. Inner plus x e to the x. And last plus e to the x. And then I still have this minus x e to the x out back. And x plus 1 squared on the bottom. Okay, so what can I get rid of? Well, I can get rid of a positive x e to the x and a negative x e to the x. And then what do I have left? Well, out of what I have left on the top, every term has an e to the x. So I'm going to go ahead and factor that out. And then what I'm left with is the quantity x squared plus x plus 1. And then that's all over x plus 1 squared. And that is as far as we can go with this one. So this is our final answer.